So this is what we work as a collective, or as a collaboration we call the digital enterprise. We're exploring the notion of the continuous self, linking the physical end of life to the digital continuation, because I will come back to this a bit, what's my interest and, in my practice and what's Henning's background, because our backgrounds are so different, how we actually came together for this collaboration and what our shared interests and what's our different professions, how this comes together. And we will talk about, actually, mainly our first project we did was a symposium that we had in Amsterdam that included an exhibition or an installation. Next to that, we both had two lectures that we gave, and one was more, not from your background, but one was really based on my background on image culture. It is indeed a weird thing, I have to say, because this is quite different. So we'll start introduce ourselves separately, and then we'll give a short introduction about our collaborative practice, and then we'll go on. With two little snippets out of our longer talks that will, it's not really about cryptography, but it's more about problems that death or a digital death, what a digital death can mean, but also what's the problem of death in your continuous self according to your privacy. Because we always talk about living people, but when you die, I mean, you're still online available with your data. So it will be a short excerpt of our longer talks, and Emily will introduce herself first.
Yes, my background has always been in end-of-life and death. My first degree is in social anthropology, and I lived and worked in Romania and Transylvania, looking at the idea of social death within the first hospice in the country. So this idea that people had already made a step towards death when they entered the hospice before they physically died. And since then, I've pursued a PhD in medicine, looking at specialising in the final 3 days of life and how dying and death differs depending on where people die. So this is from a number of different kind of perspectives, the kind of anthropology of the built environment, how people experience the dying process according to different settings, and also very kind of basically medical stuff. The drugs and procedures and care that people get as they die in a hospital or hospice or nursing home.
I will not talk about any world of myself in detail, but it's more that my general interest is, so I said, design and research, because it's just a field that I like to investigate through design, and this is actually the coexistence of the physical and the virtual, and then it's how it has an impact on each other. So it's actually that's how also the connection comes with the death thing, what's the physical death with the continuous digital self, physical death. Especially, I'm interested in this relating it to the creation of personal identity, so actually how we represent ourselves. This is something I find quite interesting. So the project, actually last year I was working really a lot just on selfies with, from different kind of perspectives, but this you can check on the website. I'm interested in investigating occurring consequences of identities when they traverse diverse media. So actually your example is quite a nice one for this, in the sense of, but actually it was funny that when he made a book out of it, he just realized, actually learned about his behavior online, which is, I think it's quite funny, maybe it's because he's young, I don't know, just posting everything, and you see the printed stuff, and then I don't know if he thinks that the printed is still the truth or something, but it's actually one of the points that's quite interesting for me in this project. Because also once your virtual identities and your physical identity, digital technology, it's just all your identity is just available for everyone with a connection. You can still talk about persons who might edit everything or add something to your identity, though you don't know it, but still it can it's just lies about your identity, and maybe you don't know about it. Because you can end up as a profile picture for a Twitter book, like Robbie Williams was promoting an Erdogan campaign on Twitter without even knowing it, but still people thought it was really so bad. Or Robbie Williams fans were quite pissed off that he was promoting Erdogan in Turkey 2 years ago. Main words of my or points in my work, but I think it's interesting. What interests me most is just this dispersion, multiplication, acceleration. As I see, this just as a characteristics of our different age. So this also conclude this that identity is just now just more time-based thing. So it's really just one moment that you. Let it be a selfie, so it's really just for this moment that it's there, but someone drags it to the laptop, it becomes another image compression would already add something to the image that you upload. And so in a way it becomes also part of this identity, of this representation. So our online identities or images get just, they live their own lives. So instead of being a representation of an object, I think they kind of are participative subjects, maybe. So these kind of things are what I'm quite interested to investigate in my work, not to play longer than expected. So together, we have this collective. So this is a photo of our this installation part that we did for our first symposium called Digital Death and the Postmodern Self. It was more a general introduction about what the digital death mean. So to just briefly describe, this is the things on the ground that are projected from the top, from the ceiling, and it's two underneath here, it's two corpses, and there's a third one in the back. Especially digital death shrouds that each of us tells three aspects of our ongoing research. So we had a lot of calls what the digital death could mean on the right. On the left, it's more an image conclusion, what happens to your online self once you're physically dead. And the one in the back is more about personalizing domains, suffixes for if you want to leave a message afterwards, once you die, you can already prepare because what you want to tell people with your memorial site. Because memorial sites are totally a bad thing that actually others did for you, but now if you could plan your digital afterlife, would it be an option that you always start thinking about what it should look like? There's another view from the other side. So the crucifix, I will come back in a bit. This is a detail. So it's all moving images, it's just some gifts that are looped. So there are one now on the left is just some lot of quotes, famous quotes about death, where we just had a digital audio. This is not playing. This neither. Actually, it should move quite well. So this was more digital tombstone as a projection on the digital death shroud. Anyway, just talking and talking. The same with this one, actually it should move and show all the different kinds of suffixes that are personalizing your afterlife memorial site that you would create yourself. So this is the crucifix, we did this early collaboration with artist Selvig Tildemann, and we just adjusted the original crucifix to more nowadays the selfie cross. So you have actually 35 degrees high, 45 degrees in front of you that you would get nailed to the cross just that you can take selfies. And so that's what we did. I tried a flat face and we got some smiling there. Around this we had a workshop that, because it took place on the 3rd of April, the Good Friday, so we thought, we have it as an abstraction of the human body, but also maybe it's a fun of the human part to add some blasphemy. And so we had 666 hashtags concerning death and the Good Friday and religion and Jesus. And so we had this workshop of people just joining in and really spreading it on Instagram to all these kind of hashtag communities. We expected a bit more response. Because actually people apparently didn't care. So, yeah. You?
So, a major part of this project has been looking at the difference between dying in different ways. So I mentioned earlier the concept of social death. That you can die in a way by being separated from your usual social circle and social standing roles. And the internet and global technology has made this more important because you live now in so many different ways. You don't just live in the physical world, you live online, and you may have quite fractured and different identities online. And you die in these different ways. And something that's happened recently in the US has been laws that have been developed around the image rights of corpses. And a lot of this has come from a couple of different cases, the most high profile being a case of a girl called Nikki Katsoulis, who died in a very high impact car crash. She had very, very severe injuries. She was almost decapitated. And two California Highway Patrol officers, who were the first responders on the scene, took photographs. And the accident actually happened on Halloween, and they sent these photographs through to their friends and family as some kind of ghoulish kind of prank, I guess. And these images then ended up online in a wider sense. And the family kept on getting these images back, and they were hidden, actually in some cases they were physically mailed through, or they were hidden as emails that were related to the parents' work, and this horrible image kept on going back on the family. And when it was first taken to court, the Highway Patrol officers were found to have done nothing wrong, because in the law as it existed at the time, sharing an image of someone in that way hadn't been legislated against. But the fact that we can now share images much more widely and circulate them to a much larger audience has made those old laws more or less obsolete, because they don't legislate for that level of dispersion. So what happened on appeal is that the Highway Patrol officers were found to have done wrong, and a new set of statutes was drawn up concerning accident photos specifically, but also photographs of corpses. And this is interesting because it gives dead people fundamentally different image rights from living people. So you can be in the background of a kind of street shot that can be shared all over the world as a living person, and that's completely legitimate. But now as a dead person, that can't happen. And this isn't kind of small crimes. There's quite hefty punishments for now sharing these images of corpses widely. Up to $5,000 and 6 months in prison as your number of violations of this kind of law increases. And the only situations explicitly mentioned in the bill now that allow you to take photographs of corpses and circulate photographs of corpses are within these courses of law enforcement, investigations, medical examinations and funeral services. They can't travel outside of these circles anymore. And this is an artist who kind of deliberately flouts this by going to crime scenes and taking selfies, or having somebody take a photograph of her almost as if she were the passerby at a crime scene to try and draw attention to the different rights of the living and the dead. And it's really the digital world and the proliferation of social networks that has led to the change. If we didn't have this ability to share everything digitally and globally, then there wouldn't be
let your profile become a memorial page, but it's also quite a pain in the ass really to realize it, or to delete an account is even worse because it takes at least 6 months till you get your account removed from Facebook if you die. And so basically you're in this digital in-between transcendent sphere just because of Facebook. So this year, I think it was in February or March, where they changed the terms of conditions to make it easier and faster to die on Facebook. And so they added a little form that you have to fill in and we have to confirm that there was sent a certificate, not really an official death certificate, but just an obituary would have been enough. And, so you fill in the form and in the end you upload this image of an obituary just for a newspaper, for example, or a screenshot. And this thing was still optional, so actually it was not really strict how you could delete an account of someone you know who died and want to get this account deleted, because in 2013 there was a guy, I have to find his name, I'm sorry, Russell Foster, who just found out that he died on Facebook and his account was deleted, but it was only deleted because someone else uploaded an obituary with the same name. But this guy now was, who just found out he died, he was 20-something. The guy who actually died 2 years before was 74 or something. So per accident, this guy died on Facebook, and after a few days he got resurrected because he claimed he went to the lawyer and got his rights back. But actually this ended up to be a thing for a strategy, how to